There is a war between the rich and poor, a war between the man and the woman. There is a war between the ones who say there is a war and the ones who say that there isn't. Why don't you come on back to the war? That's right, get in it. Why don't you come on back to the war? It's just beginning.
Welcome, everyone, to the 12th issue and podcast of Prosperity Marxism. I'm here with Michael Pelias with my co-host, Peter Bratsis, who joins us from the lovely Aegean island of Kassos in Greece. He's relaxed on a staycation, I guess they call it, or something, and he'll stay in the Greek islands throughout the pandemic, I hope. And anyway, today we have a really a great program lined up. We're going to remember the life and work of our dear departed comrade Bill DiFazio. And we're joined today, and I'll introduce them both more specifically, but we're joined by Heather Gautney and David Van Arsdale, two students and then professors now who were very close to Bill and whose lives were certainly changed and whose work has been influenced by Bill. And we're going to go through this in the course of the program. Simultaneously, I think it's very, very important to remember that Bill DiFazio was an exceptional person. He was a person who came from a working class background. He had a communist uncle in Brooklyn. His father was a longshoreman. Bill also had a Jewish mother, Italian working class on the waterfront, so to speak. And of course, he liked Salt of the Earth much better as a film about the working class, but certainly understood on the waterfront. And if there was ever the Salt of the Earth, it was Bill, really, in many ways, which was really wonderful characteristic of his. I met Bill in the 80s through Stanley Aronowitz, and we hit it off very well. We had several things in common, particularly a love of jazz and especially a love of Sonny Rollins, who was his favorite jazz saxophonist, although we get into arguments about, you know, Coltrane and Rollins, who was better, who had more contribution to make, et cetera. That's how it went, you know, in our early career. He also helped on the project in the Everyday Life group he would come to often at the Graduate Center, which was a kind of special reading group that came out of some of Stanley Aronowitz's students. And Bill would participate in this, and I got to know him a little better. And then, of course, our relationship became much more stronger in the post 9/11 and when we started the journal Situations. And Bill, along with Peter here, were two of the co-founders, and Heather actually was there too. Was part of the co-founders of the journal Situations project of the Radical Imagination. And Bill contributed a very good piece on memory on the film Memento, and a very interesting piece about history, memory, and what we're doing today, maybe remembering him this way. So for me, I always found the conversations to be always very practical. I found Bill never separated the intellect from everyday life and vice versa, right? He was always engaged with the world. You could go out to eat with Bill and you were engaged with ideas. You were engaged with the people in the world. And he had a very special quality, to my mind, of knowing how to handle everybody from the person in the diner all the way up to the, you know, snobbish intellectuals that he'd go after at conferences. So Bill really had this great ability to read people and think of people, you know, in terms of their context and their respective, you know, position, and have great respect for that, yeah, in many ways. And I always admired that about him. And later in the show, David will show us maybe some of his ethnography, some of the work that he left behind that maybe will, you know, hopefully get a preview of today. So anyway, I want to introduce both of the guests. David von Arsdale is a professor of sociology at SUNY Onondaga Community College, and he is the author of The Poverty of Work, Selling, Servant, Slaves, and Temporary Labor on the Free Market, which was published by Haymarket Press in 2018. I know of his work and have talked to him in the past about his very good work on contingent labor, temporary labor, and I remember the very interesting statistics he did about contingent labor as being the most biggest moment here now in as we move into the new depression. And I think his work is going to take on a new impetus and a new thoughtfulness as we go forward. So yes, and David knew Bill from 1996 on, and he'll speak to that, how he met him, etc. And actually, the other person is Heather Gautney, who's joining us, who's a professor of sociology at Fordham University. She was one of the chief strategists for the Bernie Sanders campaign, and we're hoping that she'll end up in a crucial position in the education department or in some place where she has made a difference always wherever she's gone, but maybe now it's time to do so on the national governmental level. She's also the author of her last book is Crashing the Party, which was a kind of an ethnography, if you will, of the Bernie Sanders 2016 campaign, and a very interesting attempt to really look at the Sanders influence on a generation. And she was certainly in the forefront of analysis of what the Sanders campaign made, what the upsurge or our revolution was. I think you were, correct me if I'm wrong, one of the political consultants to our revolution or part of that aspect, right? And
I was their executive director for like 8 months.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we have the revolution present with us then. Okay. Executive director. Right. So I'd like to talk about Bill's work. Again, this is a great loss to us. I'm sorry that Bill had been, sick for quite a long time. The amazing thing to me, every time I visited, he was always in good humor, always in a good mood, and was always engaged. And he wanted to talk about ideas always. So he never lost that, and he was really very determined that way. You go over to his place, he wants to talk about Max Weber, something in Weber. He wants to talk about the critique of postmodernism. And we both shared a great love for Antonio Gramsci's work and would speak about that. And, of course, we're played to his Italian background. So I'm gonna maybe divide this session into multiple categories. Maybe, first of all, turn it over to Heather, talk about her relationship to Bill early days, and then how she was maybe struck, changed, by Bill and other things, and then David doing the same in terms of the transformative activity that went on between, mentor and pupil, if you will, or mentor and mentee, or what happened in terms of, the development of a very equal relationship that I think was extremely cross-fertilizing for both of you. So Heather, please,
Sure, so, it's definitely not an overstatement to say that Bill changed the course of my life and was also he was there with me during very important moments in my life. Before I came to St. John's and met him, I was in Washington working at a non-governmental agency and really had no idea what to do. I had a sort of what I think of as a kind of unformed politics. So I had working class outrage, but I didn't have any way of framing it or understanding it. So I was sort of professionally aimless and politically aimless as well. The I had been rejected for in graduate programs and extremely distraught by that, and told that I would never make it in graduate school. So I applied to St. John's sort of on a whim, and Bill saw, he told me, he said he saw something in my application and sort of overlooked the deficiencies in it. And I, his class was the first class that I took. And to be honest, it was a blessing that it happened that way, because I don't know if I would have stuck with it if I hadn't met Bill, and if he wasn't teaching this particular subject matter, which was sociological theory. And now, and I've gone on, that's the one of the only classes I teach. So, you know, it's sort of a, there's a poetry to this with Bill. The things about the way that Bill taught theory, you know, he would sit in front of the class with the book, which had all kinds of scribbling in it, and he would read from the book, and then he would stop, and we would digest. And the digestion always included stories about his time in SNCC. It included stories about his working class background. And there was this sort of underlying and sometimes not underlying message to us, like, if I can be a professor, or if I can get a PhD in sociology, you definitely can, right? Because I'm this guy who used to drop acid and hang out and come from this, you know, bubble background. And that was incredibly meaningful to me. He inspired me at a level that is very difficult to explain. Like, the level of excitement that I got going to his class and even running into him on the bus was high. He became the sort of center of my world. So the theory, you know, the other thing that I was thinking about with the theory, not just the way that he laced his politics, but he also, there was a sort of work habit thing that, and I think Michael and David, you might have mentioned this before about his note-taking. There was this kind of combination of, if I can do it, you can too, with this, well, this is how it's done. And I had come, you know, from being a terrible student as an undergrad, sort of, you know, hanging out, not paying a lot of attention and half reading things. And the habits that Bill had, the opportunity that he gave me, and then the excitement of the sort of political project that was embedded in becoming a sociologist, studying Marx with Bill, learning how to do ethnography, all of those things together. You know, I found myself, when we got to Parsons, reading the social system twice and taking notes on every section of it, almost rewriting the book in a shorter version. That was something I would have never done. But Bill motivated me to comprehend things that I struggled to comprehend. And then we had the added blessing of being able to situate what Parsons represented, you know, in the larger political context in which he was operating. So it was an amazing experience, and definitely a transformative experience in taking his class. Of course, you know, Bill was the first person to teach me Mills, and now I'm sitting down writing a rewrite of The Power Elite. I've been doing it for 5 years now, and I imagine it's probably going to take me another five, unfortunately. But he, you know, he was the one, having been, you know, involved in that politics, who presented that to me, and then, you know, sort of introduced me to Stanley Aronowitz, who I would then go on to study with and develop a relationship, a very important transformative relationship as well. You know, taking theory with Bill, you felt like you were taking a class in Marx and Marx only to realize that you hadn't actually learned other theorists, but you walked away a Marxist, and for good reason. And it was sort of like he brought out the Marxist in us that was there, at least for me, since I was probably 12 years old, but I had no idea that I was analyzing the world and seeing the world in that way. So it was very, very personal. Just so quickly, I don't want to take up too much time, but quickly, you know, he stressed the importance of ethnography. He was a real ethnographer. He spent years and years with people. And I taught ordinary poverty in one of my classes over the last few years. And Bill at one point had come to visit and talk to the students about ethnography and the amount of time that's required to spend with people to really understand what's going on. I have beautiful memories of sitting, you know, this is how much Bill was the center of my life. I moved to Greenpoint where he lived shortly after I moved to New York, and I lived right around the corner from him. I spent time in diners with him and Susanna. When my father died, I went to Bill's house and cried, and he and Sue gave me popsicles and, you know, made me feel better. They were the first people who I spent that, you know, my mourning over my father's death with. That, you know, that's how close they were. And I'll say before, you know, I mean, there's a lot more to say, but Bill was very intellectually inclusive. And, you know, when you're new to graduate school and you're not, you know, feeling confident in your ability to read complex, to process complex ideas and read sort of high theory, you know, he would invite us graduate students to dinners. When we showed up at the American Sociological Association, Bill brought us in with him and kind of took us around. And you just sort of felt like you were part of something that was bigger than academia. And he invited us to Susanna's art shows, and then we would go to dinner afterwards and drink with people whose books we read and admired. And so it was like Bill, you know, people often associate Stanley with having a sort of scene around him, and I was part of that scene at one point, but Bill had a little scene too of people, students who he cultivated, who admired him a great deal and who were sort of turned out by him. And I proudly include myself in that group of people. And then I'll just say one more. I'm just looking at a note that I spent my 30th birthday with Bill, and I'll never forget photographs of this on, you know, one of those outdoor, what do you call them? The feasts, I guess he used to call them, but it was like, an outdoor party on the west side. And there was an Italian restaurant there, and he knew everybody in it and brought me back into the kitchen and to watch them make the mozzarella. And then we sat there and ate this gigantic piece of lasagna. And that's just, you know, it's like when you think about Bill, it's like, whoa, my father's death, my 30th birthday. Like, what else, what seminal sort of moments in my life did I spend with him? And, you know, it's sort of profound the way in which he sort of marks different really important parts of my life. And then, you know, when I got married, he and Glenn hit it off beautifully, and we had a lot of lovely dinners with Sue, Susanna, and just, you know, like you said, he talked to everybody, and he was so political with people. You know, it was really, he was turning people out, like, who were, you know, putting coffee on the table. And, you know, he just was a really friendly, fun, profoundly down to earth person. And anyway, I'm just really grateful for knowing him, because I don't think that I would be doing any of the things that I'm doing now if I hadn't been lucky enough to meet Bill. I really have no idea what I would be doing. It's frightening, actually, to think about it.
That's a very beautiful, testament to him, and homage as a beginning to this, and very personal. And obviously, you were more than touched, you know, and changed, and and it's been retained, which is really the beautiful part of all this. David, do you want to maybe talk a little bit, follow on Heather's beautiful, poetic and organically constructed remembrance here?
Yeah, absolutely. I can hear the emotion in Heather's voice, and there's bound to be some emotion wrapped up in this talk today, because he just was an incredibly special man. But just a little context, maybe. St. John's University, it's a big Catholic university, but the sociology program, there's not a doctorate program. The highest degree offered in the sociology and anthropology department at St. John's was the master's degree, and of which Heather and I both graduated from. And we actually had others in our class that were, that would speak equally about Bill, Paul McKierney, and I'm forgetting David's name, Heather, but he also went on to finish his PhD from our class. And that's just, I'm just talking about one class. It's a small master's program. It's not a big master's program. But as I've, over the years, since I've graduated from the program, gone to sociology conferences and presented and whatnot, and run into others from St. John's program and others historically from that program, he produced men, I'm saying he, I mean the program produced, but really people would say that, he was the reason that they went on to get a PhD and become professors in sociology. There's a long lineage of students that he's produced from that relatively small program. And I think Heather and I would probably both agree that we feel really fortunate to be able to sit here and speak probably for a lot of others for a lot of other students that could say, really emotional and intense, kind words about Dr. DiFazio. So just to give you a sense of how I met Bill and his inspiration on my life, I had read actually some chapters from The Jobless Future as an undergraduate student. And so I decided that I wanted to, inspired by those chapters, that book is written by Stanley Ronowitz and Bill DiFazio. I had decided when I went to the American Sociological Association, I tried to meet with Billy. I looked up his biography. I wanted to go to graduate school in New York City. I knew I wanted to go to a sociology program. I was going to school at the time as an undergrad in school down in Florida, a small liberal arts school. I wanted to get back to the Northeast where I was from. And anyway, so I sent Bill an email, and he was happy to meet with me at the ASAs in New York. This would have been the summer of 1996. And we had lunch and pretty instantly hit it off. We had lunch and we talked about the program, and we talked about our backgrounds and sports, and pretty soon he was giving me a tour of Midtown, and I think we probably all agree that there are a few people that know the history of New York the way that Bill DiFazio does, that was the start of something special. I applied to the program at the time that Heather and I both started the program. Bill was the chair of the program, so he probably had a little extra weight deciding who got in. I had started a series of programs in St. Petersburg, Florida that helped the homeless. And, he at the time had started, research at St. John's Bread and Life Soup Kitchen. He was already working there as a researcher and this is in Brooklyn. It's a large homeless shelter, or large soup kitchen rather, in Brooklyn. And so, we were both really spending a lot of time working with homeless and hungry populations me in St. Petersburg, Tampa area, him in New York, and I think we that was common ground for us. So when I started at St. John's, I was fortunate enough to become his research assistant and started going to the food pantry with him in Brooklyn right away. And it was right away that he started to teach me how to take field notes and, you know, to not worry about errors in notes and editing and, you know, just to write down what I heard and to not worry about spelling and how it looks and all those sorts of hangups that often, you know, stop young students from scribbling down what they think and what they hear. And, you know, that I still remember those first lessons, like in the first days of meeting him, that were really valuable lessons on how to take notes. Now, that, of course, snowballed into many other intellectual discoveries. But that alone is still worth a lot to me. And I still teach some of those lessons on how to do ethnography. But more than anything, you know, he put himself right in the middle of the increasing poverty situation in the mid-90s in New York City. He was right in the middle of it. And that's where that's what the poverty at work grows out of. He was right in the middle of increasing poverty that was hurting ordinary people. And, you know, that becomes ordinary poverty. But anyway, like Heather mentioned about being professionally and politically aimless, I was 22 years old. You know, my parents weren't college educated, factory workers in Syracuse, New York. And my dad was unemployed off and on, a good portion of my childhood. And, I'd heard about, you know, socioeconomic class and strata as an undergraduate student. Did I have a sense of what manufactured it? Did I have a sense of even, basic historical sense of capitalism, a basic historic sense of the economy and how it functions? I didn't, you know. So many of my first classes with Dr. DiFazio, that's what I called him back then. Eventually, I start calling him Billy because our friendship grew. But anyway, Dr. DiFazio, he had this way of teaching us the economy and social reality that was unlike anything I had learned before, as Heather has already indicated. It wasn't just about the analysis of real text, which, you know, you can go to school in a lot of places and just read summaries. We never read summaries. We always read real text, whether it was Parsons, whether it was Durkheim, whether it was Weber, whether it was Butler. We always read real text, and we always analyzed real text in context. He always put it in context. He always compared it to new theory, new ideas. And, and he was vulnerable in front of us. You know, that's why we loved him as students. I mean, I wouldn't think of missing one of his classes. I don't think any of us would, really. I mean, it was a, I did my undergraduate work in a lot of behavioral science. I quickly, left, the world of blaming social problems on individuals, after a few classes with Billy, and then it expanded, into a whole nother realm for me, and it's still unfolding. Look, there's so much more to say in this regard, but I do want to say that, Billy always thought that in academia, students, sort of stand on the shoulders of their professors, right? And he has his own lineage, which we may get into, but, his mentors meant a ton to him. George Fisher meant the world to him, Bill Kornblum meant the world to him. Stanley meant the world to him. He had his mentors, and he produced, he was my mentor. And I hope I can do him justice in the coming years. He was you know, smarter. And I think, you know, if somehow we could publish what was in his head, we would have a library of texts. It's unfortunate that he ran into some health problems the last, you know, 15 years of his life that really deterred, I think, what would have been a prolific, you know, 30 more years of writing post ordinary poverty. You know, it is what it is, right? So so hopefully Heather and I and Paul and McKierney and others will pick up the mantle and keep writing in his spirit. I guess I'll leave it there.
Right. Peter, you want to maybe mention a couple of things? I know you know the Longshoreman book, and you had a good relationship over the years with Bill. And yeah, and we went to Baltimore with him, remember? We went to defend Stanley's book together. We were like the warriors on the way to defend a different concept of class. It was a lot of fun. But anyway, please. Yeah.
I mean, I met Bill after I had read some of his work, you know. Of course, the book with Stanley, The Jobless Future, and then The Longshoreman, which came out in the 80s, I think 85. And it was his dissertation, and it was on, of course, the struggles in Brooklyn around the automation of the port, you know, the move to containerized shipping, and how that struggle played out. And let me just say, I think now it's probably long out of print. But it's, I think, an especially relevant work. There's a copy right there, David's holding up. But I think pertinent work in this discussion of guaranteed incomes and so forth. Because one of the points that Bill uncovered, of course, was that part of the deal the union made was that the existing then longshoremen, the people who were then employed in the port of Brooklyn, would get pensions. You know, the union would accept the move to containerized shipping, and in exchange, the existing employees, the ones who were let go, which was the vast majority, obviously, would get pensions. You know, some were quite young, in their 40s and so forth. And one of the findings of was that people didn't necessarily take the pension, they'd go find other jobs. You know, for a significant fraction of that population, they were happy to live off the pension and do things that were meaningful to them, rather than trying to maximize how much income they could make, you know, in a given year. As people might expect, you take the pension and then you you get another job and make a lot more money, you know, in your 40s and 50s. So I think this says a lot about the real attitude towards work people have, and how liberating it can be, of course, to be emancipated from the need to work, and how it opens you up to more possibilities, even in the current culture and the current context, where there's such a continuing dogma of workerism and getting ahead and, you know, maximizing incomes and so forth. And then, of course, a lot of those questions continued to the book with Stanley, the Jobless Future, which went certainly well beyond the question of longshoremen to all these other industries, to show how, of course, automation was having already a huge transformation of these industries, and of course in the foreseeable future we get even much more worse. And that was 1991 or 92,
right? So and reissued in a second edition, of which both the new preface and an afterword were written both by Stanley and Bill for the new edition.
Again, it's an especially prophetic, or, you know, much before a lot of the much more current literature on automation. Now, of course, it's become a mainstream question of automation, the need for a guaranteed income, or some other way, of course, of allowing people to survive rather than getting jobs, because it becomes more and more impossible to survive from working in the
And to my mind, certainly one of the most original readings of the Grundrisse, of Marx's Grundrisse, and especially the fragment on machines, done by Bill, who taught the Grundrisse many times at the forum. This was another aspect of Bill's pedagogy. He would take it to the forum and do a special seminar there for many, many years. As well, of course, I can mention this too. And I think at least maybe David's been on the program too, but City Watch was a program of Bill's, WBAI, that he really loved, Heather too, of course. And, this was a wonderful thing that he prepared. He really prepared the going back to this taking of notes. Bill would sit there and you go into the studio and he had a stack of notes about what he was going to talk about, how he would introduce, how the interview would go, et cetera. So it was really wonderful. I mean, unfortunately, and maybe fortunately, I and Jeremy Glick and I were the last persons on his program when it was done live, at the studio downtown on Wall Street, the old WBAI headquarters, and then he did it remotely for a number of times and occasionally at the Commons in Brooklyn, but this was right before that, where he was relegated to a wheelchair, unfortunately. We were with him 2 days before that happened, which was extremely sad, when I learned about that. I remember going to visit him every day in the ICU, for over a month, and finally got out and he went back to work. It was a lot of courage during this period, to my knowledge. I would go visit, like Heather. In fact, I saw Heather in Greenpoint a couple of times. Their new place, they bought a place at the pencil factory, which fits with his background. A pencil factory conversion was the apartment. And
on the waterfront.
Love the view. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So, but he was always, extremely, again, gracious and open and really wanted to discuss ideas. And just going back to what Peter said just for a second, also, this whole thing that he did with Stanley and even before Stanley really anticipated and, worked parallel to Negri's work on zero work, the Italian autonomia, group, and very, very interesting. And this is kind of forgotten by a lot of people on the left. This is another thing we have to remind leftists of how interesting not only this period was, the why work, or, the last great job in America, as Stanley wrote, about his own job and having his own time. And of course, Bill with his contribution, both in the jobless future and before in ordinary poverty, afterwards in ordinary poverty. Anyway, I'd like to just, maybe we can go back again, can you remember really, I know the initial encounters in the St. John's, but were there any particularly really transformative moments that you can recollect in terms of the reading or the conversation or where you had this kind of moment of like, I'm really in the presence of, something very different here, besides the first awe-inspiring moment of the good professor or the professor that's opened, you up to different things. But anything that can really stick out as a transformative moment? I mean, in my conversation was always talking about, Stokely Carmichael. These are people that I, had great admiration for. And, Bill knew Stokely, worked in SNCC for years and, wrapped around, and we went through a lot of the history of Black militancy. And for me, this was always a great upsurge to talk to him. It's inspiring. But the two of you that really worked with him in a strong, and maybe a stronger way, I remember. Yeah.
For me, Heather, if you don't mind, I'll just because it came to mind here, I'll say that, well, it was the first, I think it was the first round of classical social theory. It was soon into that class that we read from the 1844 manuscripts, and the German ideology comes to mind. And, Bill had a lot to say about ideology, of course, but, where I can almost see him saying, or reading, you know, in class, you know, the part where Marx and Engels are discussing, you know, that you could separate man by consciousness however you like, you know, and metaphysics, religion, you know, what have you. Man is separate from animal as soon as he produces his means of subsistence and thereby also produces his mental intercourse. And, you know, like him explaining that the power of that passage, which eventually leads to the famous quote, life is not determined by consciousness, but consciousness by life. It was a kind of like, you know, it was kind of a moment where I was, you know, really felt I was in the hands of someone who understood the making of ideas, the making of ideology, the understanding the human vulnerability to ideology. This was very important to Billy. His read of Marx and Engels was less economy and more social relations, and he often reminded us that people forgot this. And that, you know, that you know, he taught us to read, you know, he taught us to see where social relations was overlooked a lot, I think, in Marx and Engels' work, but in other works too. Anyhow, like that moment, him teaching me what ideology is and how powerful it is and how fascism is always around the corner, those moments I won't forget. I can say more there, but I'll leave it because, you know, I know time goes fast on these.
Heather can't wait.
Yeah, jump in, Heather, jump in.
Man is now abstract being squatting outside the world.
You're right, yeah, right.
Yeah. It's like the most, you know, the image, I can see Bill saying that. Yeah. But yeah, I mean, that's the... it's hard to pick one, but I agree, David, that ideology was one of the things that we spent a lot of time on. And we also spent a lot of time, Bill spent a lot of time sort of explaining to us what historical materialism was and could be. And, you know, like I'd never heard of a camera obscura before Bill, you know, like, you know, when and you have to contextualize it, right? You have people, or at least I can speak from my own. I was a blank piece of paper, you know what I mean? And he's throwing this stuff at us and we're just soaking it up. So a lot of these concepts were so brand new coming from Bill, you know, which is laced with all of this stuff, like you said, Michael, of counterculture and, you know, civil rights and all of this stuff that Bill was directly involved in, which, you know, if you're a blank piece of paper, but you're politically informed, you know, the connections were solid. Like, okay, you know, this is the analysis and this is the action, you know, and it was very motivating. I mean, not long after we studied with Bill, we started to see the Seattle stuff and people protesting the World Bank and IMF and all of that. And there was like a direct line from the stuff that we were reading to the critiques of neoliberalism and then eventually, you know, American imperialism. And if I hadn't met Bill and Bill hadn't been this vector to ideas, but also to all of these people, I wouldn't have been part of any of it, I don't think, or I don't know how it would have happened in that way. I mean, the people on the screen, Michael and Peter, David, I wouldn't know you. Like, I wouldn't have ever met you. So it's deep. The relationships that sprung from Bill were deep, and he facilitated that, you know? So alienation was another concept that that Bill... we spent a lot of time on with Bill, understanding the alienation of workers from their work product. And that was something that, you know, coming from a working class background, you really it's meaningful beyond words. You know how that's lived and what that feels like. And I'll never forget Bill teaching the commodity fetish, because I think of him every time I teach it, explaining what is a fetish? You know, what does that mean? You know, and of course our minds go
into. I can hear him now, you know.
Yeah. Pounding the table, always pounding. Yeah. On key points, always pounding the table. I mean, it was theater. It was theater.
I think both of you were extremely lucky to have him as a professor, in the sense that he had a visceral understanding. A lot of professors might be able to give you marks, but it's never really visceral in that way. You know, Bill knew what alienation meant. You know, he experienced it. He knew how to convey it. He knew, he saw it. You know, et cetera. The same thing about commodity fetishism, the same thing about how ideology permeates every aspect of our everyday lives and how powerful it is. And I think you're both extremely lucky to have had a person such as Bill, in the sense of you got the visceral knowledge. You know, it's not from the head. It was not spun out of the head, as Marx would say about, you know, the difference between the worker and the bee is the worker has consciousness. You know, Bill brought that consciousness of a kind of viscerality to the table that I think was very special. I think it marked him in many ways and made him stand out in some, you know, and also, you know, I mean, I didn't know George Fisher. I know a little about his work and et cetera, but you know, you can see why Stanley and Aronowitz and Bill were really very close, you know, in this way, you know, how much they connected gut to gut, you know, in this way, you know. And
Michael, if I could just add, it wasn't just visceral because he had this working class past.
Yeah.
It was visceral. I mean, it was that. True. But it was also visceral because of his approach to scholarship, which was to be in the streets.
Right.
You know, it was to be at the food pantry, which was to hang out with the homeless,
right,
the unemployed, the disadvantaged, to be actively involved in the politics against poverty. I mean, he was on many, many boards, during our time with him, always doing the political work with anti-hunger groups, mm-hmm, you know, so it's he didn't stop. He didn't stop the SNCC work. You know, he never stopped that. And that kept him relevant. Mm-hmm. And when Heather says, you know, you could take what, it wasn't like we're reading, theory from 1844 that was just about 1844. Like it was updated. It was also critiqued. What was wrong with it? You know, it was critiqued. Why is relevant? Why it isn't relevant to helping us understand Seattle? I mean, he was, his feet were on the ground. You know, it reminds me that, you know, Susanna, whom Heather mentioned, Susanna Heller is his wife, and her work is this. They were an amazing couple. Everybody should become familiar with Susanna's work. I mean, her work comes from the view of the ground. And the politic of it is, you know, it's inspired by walking, but is the vision of the city from the ground of New York, and it's always capturing the moment, right? And the moments change, right? The moments changed, and she captures it, and he captured it. They lived in the world always. Their politic was always relevant. It will have, you know, Susanna's continues to be, but, you know.
And the radio show was, I mean, is no small issue as well, I would add, because, to have a radio show, weekly show, that is broadcast throughout the New York metropolitan area. You know, I mean, Bill was not only a public intellectual in the sense that he served on boards, but he was also involved in popular education, like teaching the Gundrys at the Breck Forum, but also the radio program, which, you know, we had been on numerous. I think the last time we really spoke was on the, Michael and I were guests on the show a couple of years ago. I went home one day, and my daughter says, "Oh, the mayor called, and he wants you to be
Bill,
on
Bill,
the
Bill, Bill de Blasio on the
minute,
phone.
the mayor." I was like, "Oh, Bill, Bill DiFazio, not Bill de Blasio, of course." But
right.
That was also, I mean, that was, I think, how many thousands of people were?
Yeah, he had audience reach of about 40,000 to 45,000.
Totally.
Yeah.
I think that that Michael, something you said about consciousness is really sort of a word that I would use to describe the impact that he had. And I mean, imagine for people in Hungary or the Soviet, you know, Russia or wherever, when they came to a revolutionary consciousness, it was, that was a modern day version, right, of that. Bill taking people who were politically motivated, appropriately angry and, you know, smart but untapped, you know, completely, and just taking the time to transfer, you know, what I think was a revolutionary consciousness to us. And, you know, just a word about his sort of his methodologies, you know, for, I'll never ever forget this for, and I still have this, for a midterm, we had to, it was like an essay midterm, and he would just give a list of concepts and you had to explain them, right? In like, I don't know, 3 or 4 pages or however long you wanted, which for me, I do, this is how I teach theory now. Right, is always a conceptual kind of, you know, anchoring in teaching Marx, at least. And, you know, that kind of open-endedness was sort of like, well, it's up to you how much you want to know. You know, if I ask you what grand theory is, right? Well, it's up to you how much you really want to bring into this and which theorists you want to talk about and all of that and how you want to process it. And it was like magnificent because for people who are hungry, right? Oh, I don't know. My midterm was like 30 pages long. You know what I mean? Because that's what he motivated me to do, right? Was to uncover as much as I possibly could in the period of time. And also to show him that I was paying attention and that I was soaking up what he was giving, you know, was giving to us. So, and yeah, I mean, in terms of concepts, it wasn't just Marx. It was these other theorists, you know, it was, and he, you know, we
Percy Smith, very important to him.
Yeah. Stanford theory. He did that with us in a way that he kind of gave us the answer, you know, like you knew going into Parsons and Merton that these were bad people. But you didn't really know exactly why until you got through the other end of it and realized what was motivating them. And now I teach people about that. Well, this is the political standpoint of these guys versus, you know, over here. Anyway.
Totally. He always told us we can't judge the reader. We can't judge the writer until after we're done. And we may have to do a read or two before we're done. But then we can start to do the critique. And that's a lesson I carry with me as well. Freud, I mean, we learned Freud from Bill.
I mean, for our view, you know, Bill was married to a psychoanalyst the first time around. So you have that going too. It's a bad.
Yeah,
and Marcuse and the Frankfurt School. I mean, it doesn't stop. I mean, we're talking about, you know, Marx a lot, but really, I mean, but Billy was so well read, so inspirational. And just to echo something that Heather is saying, you know, St. John's was so lucky to have him, and he was really great for St. John's. I mean, St. John's attracts the working class New Yorkers for the most part. And the graduate program attracts just, you know, working class students, mostly in sociology and anthropology. So, you know, he was good for us that way. you know, and again, I mean, the students that I mean, you know, Heather went on to the CUNY Graduate Center, you know, Paul McKierney, our dear friend, went on to Columbia, I went on to Syracuse. We went on to pretty good PhD programs. And, you know, no small feat for a little program at St. John's. No small feat. He touched a lot of people.
Yeah, and I would say, David, for me, that Bill was 100% responsible for that too, because I wouldn't have known about Stanley or thought about the CUNY Graduate Center as a place to go. And, you know, that relationship was cultivated in a kind of way too, that Stanley's door was, I think, probably more open to me because of Bill. And that led to a lot of other things in terms of being able to even finance my education and being able to stay in and then doing book projects and things like that. All of it, I think, you know, it was like he sort of followed through with us, you know, to make sure that we made it to the next step and encouraged us to do that. And also, you know, cultivated relationships, especially in my case, that were necessary to, you know, taking the next step. And, you know, then that then brought me into, you know, into Stanley's fold for many years. Which, as I mentioned before, was also transformational in a kind of similar way, I have to say. But there's no way that I would have survived CUNY. What I walked into was Stanley and, you know, the kinds of classes that he was teaching, that would not have been a safe space for me walking in off of what I have off of my undergraduate experience. Yvonne was in that class. I love you, Yvonne, but you know, he's intellectually intimidating. And so were a lot of other people. Jonathan Cutler was, you know, there were a lot of people in Stanley's classes who were very intellectually intimidating. And Bill had really filled those years for me with enough confidence and intellectual content that then I was able to walk into a situation that was still over my head, but at least I could hang and then grow into it. None of that, I would have failed miserably if I had somehow encountered Stanley on my own. And without that padding of having that good training with Bill.
Excellent. Yeah, I mean, I just wanted to add another part of Bill's life. You know, Bill was the connoisseur of film as well. And I have a very good anecdote to give here. Stanley and Bill visited Montreal. It was one of the, I guess it was the American Sociological Association held a conference there. So Stanley said, we're going to go up and we'll stay at Michael's place, etc. So we were there. I invited an old friend of mine who actually translated a book called Camera Obscura, written by a French philosopher, Sarah Kaufman. Will Strauss, his name, was chairman of communications at that time and a film buff at McGill University. So they're all, and Will came over. Will's wife is a painter, and she and Susanna knew people in common, et cetera. So it was a very nice gathering. But the best part was, for a half an hour, Bill and Will knew every tertiary actor in every film from American film from 1928 until the 1950s and beyond, but that was the territory. So it's amazing that the recollection of the actor, the scene, and all of this. And I remember, you know, sometimes you go see Bill in the afternoon, he would have on a movie from the 40s, or, you know, Sullivan's Troubles about the Depression that were made in the early 30s. So this was a wonderful other quality of him besides, you know, and for me, this is great because I had a friend I could discuss these things with because of my love of film, as well as the jazz, you know, so we We always were able to connect on those kind of everyday levels, you know? And in a way, he was kind of like, again, you know, going back to this viscerality and what you talked about too, Dave, this connection to the streets. This was very special, you know, very special that very few people have, where they're able to take a walk in New York City and in one block, you know, better than Leopold Bloom in Dublin, they're able to, you know, speak to, you know, everything that's happened on that block, who played in that club, who ate in that restaurant, you know, when this structure was built, why it was built, who are the working class, you know, people in, you know, on 8th Avenue, you know, what were the struggles involved, what was the year of the strike. So this was a very wonderful quality and something that will be very sorely missed. It's very hard to produce. Again, people like you and Heather, who, and we can go now to, you know, the continuation of this work, maybe through your own work or how it's influenced it for the last, you know, segment here. But, you know, this was a very special gift, you know, and relationship that, you know, we are really losing. I mean, my you know, I'm very saddened by this craft of memory and the ability to take the streets and everyday life and bring it into one's work. This is a great loss to the world. You know, yeah,
his memory,
really over-specialized.
His, you know, memory was unmatched.
Yeah, yeah.
It wasn't, you know, you mentioned film. You know, I would just sit back and be in awe at his, you know, his understanding of film and analysis of film, but also sports. You know, the Giants, the Mets. Nobody knows the Giants and the Mets, Jazz, as you've already mentioned. I mean, his memory. Right. And right. when he read a text, it was the same way. Like, he didn't forget. He could tell you what page, you know, such and such a quote was on in many, many books. You know, it's just incredible memory.
Yeah. So maybe Heather, you want to speak to some of the lasting influence in your own work and, you know, maybe what you're appropriating and where you see the future of this kind of approach to. For scholarship, you know, as Stanley says, scholarship, but, you know, in our case, really scholarship of the first rank. Yeah. So, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think in terms of my teaching, which is important to me, I always teach theory, or I teach an inequality course as a theory course, and try to teach every course that I do, with strong theoretical anchoring. And I believe that probably in my own way, I teach that a lot like Bill did, you know, in using text and trying to draw in personal experience and encouraging people politically and personally. I'm actively carrying on Bill's legacy in that way. In terms of my political work, I mean, Bill was very engaged in city politics, and you know, it wasn't always just grassroots social movement stuff. He was also engaged in you know, sort of formal institutional politics, and obviously I am too. But my heart is in the street politics, and that all sort of grew out of the relationships that, you know, that I had with Bill, the relationships that built upon my relationship with Bill. And then finally, the biggest thing is something I mentioned earlier, that, and this is sort of a combination of Bill and Stanley together, that the project, the book project that's been centering my life. And actually, I was on City Watch. Bill invited me to talk about this project on City Watch, and when I was really early into it. And now I'm, you know, halfway or maybe even two-thirds of the way through what ended up being a much bigger project than I had ever imagined, which is to do a remake of C. Wright Mills' Power Elite. And, you know, that's sort of putting all of it together. You know, it's definitely a rewriting in a Marxist framework, so not Millsian, so it's a real rethinking of it, I think, even though maybe it's like a, backward thinking, I don't know. Maybe Mill should have thought more when he wrote it. I think it also sort of brings together the activism and the political, the formal political orientation and the outrage and the freedom to write how you want to write and not be bogged down by the sort of traditions in academia. A lot of those different things that were in Bill's work and that also I think connected Bill and Stanley together, and certainly Stanley being one of the main the country's main mill scholars, they definitely had a big impact on this project. And books are, this is not a small thing. You know, this is 7 or 8 years of your life, quite frankly, in the last year, 12 hours a day of my life. So the fact that all of this effort in this huge chunk of my life is something that came from that relationship that I have with Bill, and then subsequent relationships, I think is profound. And to me, very, very sad that he is not around to be able to look at what I've written, because I think he would be proud. And I think he was very proud of you, David, very, very proud of you. And I think he was proud of me too. It must have been very gratifying for him, because we ended up being total disciples of him.
He always spoke of you. You were the main woman in the mix, and David was always the main man. And he always spoke that way, at least to me. I want to put that out there. And I think you both know it, but yeah.
I mean, people think I was Stanley's girl.
Yeah, yeah.
But I really was Bill's girl.
We won't tell Stanley, you know. yeah. And David, you, in terms of your current work and what you did before, I mean, I'm really very fond of you. I think you're one of the leading people on contingent labor in the world, you know, and we really need to get your work out there and discussed and talk more about it, because I think that you're right in the moment. You're like Heather's in the moment with power. And of course, you know, I think she's also was on the edge of the beginning of a new political formation. So this is
as everybody here knows,
the stars, you know, so to speak.
Well, yeah. Those are very kind words. When you're not a part of the corporate academy, and I'm not, it is harder to find a way to get your work out. And it can be done. Anyway, that's a whole other matter. Your question, Bill's influence on my academic work. I when I left St. John's, I returned to the city I grew up in, Syracuse, and I entered. I was trying to decide where to go to grad school. I ended up going to Syracuse University, and but also simultaneously running a homeless shelter. And that's because I was involved, with Hunger Action Network and other groups that Billy was involved in. We were fighting hunger in New York. And so it was going to school, it was fighting homelessness, fighting poverty. My work with the homeless men at the shelter that I was involved with eventually led to a dissertation topic. They gave me the topic. They told me the homeless men told me this is the topic. Mostly men. The shelter I catered to housed mostly men. They were working, but they were working in the new contingency, right? They were working as day laborers at employment agencies, and they basically pulled me along and said, "Look, come to work with us." And the tendency is to think of perhaps the homeless at this period, this was of course the late 90s, as perhaps not having it together in some way to make it in the world. Nothing could be further from the truth. These were the old workers of the industrial class in Syracuse who lost their work and were trying to get reestablished, but they were trying to get reestablished through this massive surge of employment agencies in the Rust Belt, and they couldn't do it. And eventually, you know, they problems enter their life. The meaning is lost, and we all know how much work means and how much status is tied to it. And anyway, so I started working with them, started going out on jobs with them through agencies. And lo and behold, as I started to research these agencies, they weren't just small, you know, parochial agencies. They were owned by very large corporations, very profitable corporations, right? And you know, the late 90s is a time when Manpower and you know, True Blue and these
Labor Ready.
Yeah, Labor Ready is owned by True Blue. You know, True Blue owns 9 different brands of temp agencies, right? They had 450 agencies across the United States. You know, they were raking in, you know, $20-30 million a quarter back then in revenue, or in profit rather. So you know, this was a moment that people have to understand. This was a moment when you know, they were changing what work was. They were deunionizing. They were really changing what you know the sort of, you know, just in time. A production is on the production front, but you got to have just-in-time workers to meet the production, right? And they were supplying the just-in-time workers. Anyway, they deregulated through not just through their operations and functions, but also through their lobbying. They deregulated employment policy, you know, one company at a time, and you know, and they made the triangular employment relationship the new norm. And that now that relationship's the new norm, you don't have to follow the rules. That's what I, you know, the surge in massive, you know, unregulated employment agencies, of which there's been a massive surge in city after city after city, can only happen because nobody has to know your name in the workplace anymore. You know, so it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if you're, you know, where you came from. They don't have to know your name. They just call up the agencies when they need them. And use the workers to send them home, and they don't employ them, right? They're never on their payrolls. They're on the payroll of the agency, and the agency can be any kind of agency, right? It can be a corporate one, it can be a non-corporate one, a legal one, an illegal one, and that's kind of the new norm that we've all just accepted right now at this mm-hmm. moment. So anyway, that, you know, how did Billy, you know, what was his influence? You know, he wrote a book called The Jobless Future. I was working with the jobless, the newly jobless. He was on my dissertation committee. He read, you know, my dissertation. You know, eventually, you know, parts of my dissertation end up in this recent book, The Poverty of Work, that's out with Haymarket Books now. And you know, there's more work to be done here. You know, as we know, things don't stay the same for very long, and you know, in post-industrial capitalism, and there's more work to be done, but yeah, he was incredibly influential, both as a mentor and an academic mentor, and also as Heather started off this way, as somebody that became a sort of surrogate, you know, father is a strong word, but I watched him father, and he was an incredible father, and his daughter Laisha, I'm sure would say the same. I know she does say the same. Laisha is our friend now too, Heather and I. And you know, I watched his relationship with his father. I watched him, you know, wheel his father up and down the Coney Island boardwalk day, you know, time and time again as his father died. He was an incredible son. He was an incredible father. You know, and he taught me to be both of those things too, by the way, because I ended up having a daughter. When I was working on my doctorate program, and he was a father figure to her as well, you know, throughout her life. She wept when he passed.
Right. I would like to invite both of you to maybe write something for Situations, you know, in memory of Bill, and we could put it out and maybe commemorate his work, you know, and the forthcoming issue, and I'll be in touch about that. But it would be wonderful to have the two of you, and maybe even ask the friend you have whom I don't know, who's at Illinois Champaign.
He's at the University of Illinois at Chicago. Yeah.
Chicago, okay.
Sociology.
And, this would be wonderful. And I thank you so much. I mean, I wish we had much more time. Maybe we can do this again in a different kind of context and go back to both Bill and Stanley. Stanley luckily is still with us and he's lucid, and maybe we can, you know, figure out a way to, you know, bring Stanley in the mix and talk about, you know, the jobless present. And, you know, we can really, so it would be a nice moment maybe if we can do that. And and thank you so much. I mean, I really really appreciate you both coming on. I've been very torn up about the loss of Bill. You know, unfortunately I was not in communication with him. I kept calling and I had no idea that he lost cell service and how sick he had become. I knew he would gone out to Canarsie. I had planned to go one day and we couldn't do it. Then he was moved and we talked and we were going to meet in Brooklyn because it was close to the Barclays Center. So I was really looking forward to that, but it just didn't happen. So I really missed the last 6 to 9 months of his life, you know, unfortunately. Before that, I was, you know, actively trying to get to see him. And it always was a pleasure to hop the G train, go see Bill, you know. And
It's worth saying that it was right on the front end of COVID, which means that his family and friends haven't really been able to grieve, to come together in any sort of ceremonial way to celebrate him. So this means a lot.
Like to do, if the Left Forum is in person, if it's not in person this coming May, maybe the next Left Forum or something sponsored, we can do a commemoration, you know, to the work like we did today, but in a much more organized panel and stuff. Yeah, Heather, yeah.
And we can have a dinner at Frost.
Yes, okay, that sounds great. Yeah. That was the place. It's still open, huh? Yeah. Good. Yeah, the Frost was the great Italian restaurant. Peter, did you ever go to Frost?
No.
With us? Yeah, you would have liked it. Yeah. Great portions, and they all knew Bill. I mean, you went in and you got a table. Yeah, yeah. So great. Well, thank you so much. It was great to see both of you, and yeah, love you. And you know, when you get back to Brooklyn, Heather, we're in Brooklyn. You know, I know you're partially in Brooklyn, so please be in touch. And I want to thank everybody for listening. Of course, Peter and Casos, the co-host of Prosperity Marxism, and our producer Josh Scobo on the other line here. And thank you, Heather Gautney and David Van Arsdale. Great to see both of you, and please stay safe, be well, and continue to struggle on.
There is a war between the rich and poor, a war between the man and the woman. There is a war between the ones who say there is a war and the ones who say that there isn't. Why don't you come on back to the war? That's right, get in it. Why don't you come on back to the war? It's just beginning.